be seeing the very chic Amelia Cachapero. And the dapper Tim Day. Those two are always just flawless. There's so much I admire about Amelia, but every time I attend a conference, I'm like, what would Amelia wear? And just when I thought I had it figured out this morning, I ran into Che Yu. I almost went home and started over, Che. And then I was like, how in the world can I set the stage for the formidably intelligent and tenacious Roberta Uno? And then late last night, I was like, there is no way, Black Jesus, that I can cover all the things I want to say and what Bill Rausch would want me to say in the span of 3 minutes. In what world was Bill Rausch going to welcome people in only 3 minutes? Attending the funeral of a family friend. So let us hold the Rushmore family in our hearts. That I was asked to welcome you in his stead is truly an honor. I am welcoming the movers and shakers of the API theater community and our field. When I saw the list of attendees, I sent Sharifa an email and I said, I think you missed the Obamas. Surely the first family would not want to miss this event. And then I looked over the conference schedule and I realized that you all did not come to play. Y'all came to slay! Have you read some of the breakout titles? May I?
Yes.
Hot Asian Everything. There Will Be Awkwardness, a conversation about race. In Case of Yellow Face, Break Glass. You all are out of control. And you know what? I knew that. I knew that in 2014, as Randy was talking about, when folks were walking around blowing whistles and you could hear whistles down every single hallway. And then y'all just started blowing whistles just because, you know, bullshit. It was like, bullshit whistle, bullshit whistle. Overwhelmed with excitement and anticipation. Excitement to see some familiar faces and to get to see some new ones. And anticipation because the theme of this year's conference is moving. Seismic, of, subject to, or caused by an earthquake. Having a strong, widespread impact, earth-shaking. I can't think of a more fitting theme and call to action. We are being called to shake the ground of the American theater, the foundations of which are problematic, to say the least. Actually, the least will not do, not at this conference, so let me be more specific. We are being called to dismantle the foundations of racism and white supremacy in our field. We're being challenged to smash the intersection of racism, sexism, homophobia, and all forms of bias with the seismic force of our collective wisdom, organized action, and resistance. We are being asked to have courageous conversations about representations of the Pan-Asian and Pacific Islander community on our stages. We have also been invited to celebrate the excellence of Asian American theater. Celebrate the power of Asian stories by Asian writers with Asian actors and directors. Celebrate the importance of the API community defining its own narrative. What an extraordinary honor it is to host this historic event. Thank you, CAATA board and staff, for inviting us to be in partnership with you and for holding us accountable. Accountability brings us ever closer to our value of inclusion, and our mission to reveal our collective humanity. OSF has made a commitment to creating a safe space where API stories can be told with integrity and authenticity. We do not have all the answers. We are far from perfect, but we are prepared to model this commitment with humility and courage, and we hope that the rest of the field will join us. Friends, let us take a deep breath, lean in, and brace ourselves for seismic shifts. Thank you.
Roberta Uno in 3 minutes. I really don't, because all the things that you heard up here, she's been doing for the last 40 years. Yes. So my name is Mina Natarajan, and I'm from Pangaea World Theater, and it is a deep, deep honor and privilege for me to introduce my dear friend Roberta Uno as our keynote today. I've known Roberta in so many incarnations over the past 20 years, as artistic director of New World Theatre, which she founded in the 70s, by the way, program director at the Ford Foundation, and the current director of Arts in a Changing America, and also as an important artist and director in the field, and as a dear friend. So I speak about Roberta Uno as a dear friend right now. When I met Roberta, she invited me into her house the second day I was in Amherst, and was one of the warmest hosts I could have ever imagined. I met her mother, who was an amazing human being. And when I met Roberta, I also understood that she was one of the most visionary artists of our time. Now, in Indian dramaturgy, we have this metaphor of the script really being the boat and the unspoken being the ocean. And below that is the seabed or bedrock. Roberta has laid the foundation on which so many boats float, one of them being this Asian American theater movement. Myself and a bunch of other people, 15 other people, have been in a pre-conference for Arab American, Middle Eastern, West Asian artists for the last few days. And as we were in a circle, one of the participants, the amazing, amazing artist, Suher Hamad, said, she invoked the name of Roberta Uno. She said that, how can we speak about this movement of Arab Americans, this movement of Middle Eastern artists, without invoking the name of Roberta Uno? So Roberta has really carved space for indigenous people, Arab American, South Asian, immigrant, queer, GLBTQ, youth. In fact, many, many, many generations of young people with her visionary work at New World Theater. So she was practicing and modeling intersectionality before intersectionality became a buzzword. And then the other ocean bedrock she laid was in the world of publishing, editing and publishing seminal works like The Color of Theater, Unbroken Threads, Contemporary Place by Women of Color. And I had a young woman come to me in Pangaea the other day and said, she saved my life. That book saved my life. And in the foundation world, she also really, she laid red rocks as program director at the Ford Foundation, forging new pathways, being fearless in holding organizations and networks accountable, and be truly reflective of the demographics of this country. So in all her past work, and in her current work as director of Arts in a Changing America, that is reframing how we look at demographic shift, Roberta is selfless, building sustainable bridges, and continuing to create an ecosystem in which we're all made stronger. Through all of this, she's had an amazing active career as a director and artist. And she's one of the few women who's been a member of the directors and choreographers union. So Roberta has been creating a world in which she's intentionally breaking apart productive silos. She's changing structures and systems, which is leading to lasting change and advancing an understanding of equity that is authentic and real. In so doing, she's had a real impact in American theater. She's changed the map of American theater. She's crystal clear about her work. Her refusal to bow down to dominating cultural standards and create spaces for stories that have been invisibilized is inspirational. Whatever Roberta does, she does with passion, integrity, commitment, intelligence, joy, and deep, deep love. I have been an unqualified admirer and friend, and I'm grateful and pleased that she's become a close and trusted friend in the past few years. We are so lucky to have her here. So I invite you to welcome an amazing person who's made her mother proud. A person who's had the strength to counter cynicism and create movements, and counter injustice with her own art and with her commitment to the arts in general. I invite you to stand up and welcome Roberta Uno.
Some of you I've known for many, many years, and some of you I've just recently met and hope to meet. And last night in the shuttle van, somebody was asking me, and they said, I actually don't know your theater work. And so, you know, that's how we learn each other, is through our work and through working together. And so I thought I would introduce myself by showing you what I'm working on now, what I'm currently directing. This is really a devastating time in America, I think. You know, we're all grappling with the rage and frustration, not only of the news cycle, but of the overwhelming damage that's being done to our national character and discourse by the presidential race. The last keynote I gave was in July at the Brave New Voices Festival in DC. And fresh in our minds, we were just coming from the killings by police in Minneapolis and in Baton Rouge. And so the names of Philando Castile and Alton Sterling were in our minds, and especially in the minds and the words of the young people, 2,000 poets from across America that were channeling their rage and their pain. I've always been deeply grateful that as a theater maker, my work can speak to my deepest feelings in my heart, as well as to what is going on in our world. So I've been directing an adaptation of Dalla Brathwaite's solo show, Spirit Trials. It's a piece which deals with the criminalization of black men, the incarceration system, and an individual spiritual and literal trial, legal trial. So we started this work at the Center for New Performance at CalArts, which is an amazing place for professional artists to do their work. And in 2 weeks, two more people were killed. Terrence Crutcher in Tulsa, and Keith Lamont Scott in Charlotte, North Carolina. These were the latest killings caught on videotape, forcing us, as James Baldwin urged us, to bear witness. And as Ida B. Wells fought her entire life to document the story. So I'm just going to show you a little clip from that.
It was the front page of the business section that quantified our cultural presence in America. So, you know, I'm not a demographer, but if you ever want to use this fact, it's very, very helpful. Right now, or actually at that time, there were 36,000 Chinese restaurants in America. That was more than the number of McDonald's, Burger King, and Wendy's combined. That fact still exists, only the number has So that kind of tells you, you know, we're permeating every small town between the coasts, between the borders. So as we've all heard, and we're just going to run some headlines here, by 2042 it is projected that people of color, Asian Americans, Latinos, Blacks, Indigenous people, Middle Eastern people, etc., in aggregate, will eclipse the historic Caucasian population. And this change is rolling up from the next generation. Since 2011, minority babies are the majority being born. Maria de Leon from the National Association of Latino Cultures, Arts and Cultures, says every 40 seconds, a young Latino turns 18. And APAs are poised to overtake Latinos. This shift to what I call a new American plurality has already occurred in major metropolitan areas like California and Texas. And the change we see in America is going way beyond the borders and historic gateway cities to the heartland. Of course, the shift alone is not a victory. You know, it's not just like, there's more of us, we won. When I saw this, I actually have to say it tastes pretty good. And there's spicy Thai and Hawaiian barbecue too. You know, it's kind of like when I was in college and the first Asian American appeared on Wheaties box. I got it. Somehow I put that image in the show I was directing, even though, you know, I don't even know if it makes sense. I'm a director, I can justify anything. But you know, what is this really the extent of our success? Just, is it about bringing flavor to the mainstream or being a marketing demographic? You know, are we just the four F's of 90s cult, multiculturalism, food, fashion, festivals, and free tickets? Or do we stand on the shoulders of last century's visionaries to do something larger? As James Cass has said, this is a whisper to a roar moment. We have the opportunity to change some basic power paradigms and basic cultural frameworks that really are antiquated. I mean, even just look at the language, majority, minority. What does that mean? You know, it's like, you're the majority, but we're still gonna keep you a minority. You know, it's this oxymoronic language, like ugly beautiful or soft rock, you know. Jumbo shrimp, you know. So we're gonna look at the spaces of power slide. I believe and I hope we are looking at much more fundamental change. The Oscars were just symbolic of the institutional shifts that haven't yet happened. This is a New York Times photo collage. It recently looked at 500 of the most powerful people in American culture, in business, education, and government. They found only 44 people of color. So we're gonna take a quick look in a second. The people of color are in yellow boxes. And it starts with the CEOs of the largest companies. This is gonna go by very quickly. I don't know if you can dim the lights a little bit. These are government leaders. This is corporate America. President of his cabinet, presidents of Ivy League universities, US senators, Hollywood executives who choose what movies are made, people who decide what music gets produced, mayors of largest cities, people who determine what books we read, people who greenlight television shows, people who decide what news gets covered, the Supreme Court, American governors, America's top military advisors, and then owners of pro teams, sports teams, which are dominated by people of color. So you can see we have a long way to go. Majority of arts funding goes to large organizations with budgets greater than $5 million, which represent only 2% of the entire sector. And these organizations primarily focus on Western European art forms, and their programs serve audiences that are predominantly white and upper income, as well as their institutional structures are not diverse. Marion Jobe actually asked me to speak from a personal point of view and to tell a little bit of my own APA story. So I'm gonna share some family photos in a second that speak to these issues. I was born in Hawaii when it was a territory. Yes, I'm that old. And I was raised in Los Angeles, and I have deep roots in both places. I read in Wikipedia recently that Hawaii is actually the only state that has never had a Caucasian majority. There's a reason. I mean, I think there's a reason why Hawaii is as progressive as it is. It was the first state and the only state to have a dual language policy, Olelo Hawaii and English. It was the first state to legislate gay marriage. And it was also the native state of the first woman presidential candidate, Patsy Mink. For those of you who watch the Olympics, all those women are part of her legacy. She was a champion of Title IX. So yeah, she was before Shirley Chisholm and before Hillary. And Hawaii is a place that some extremists have even failed to recognize as a state. Like, it's perhaps one of the best examples of the global future and global connectedness of America. And And it's also a place where Native Hawaiian leadership has connected us to the past and the possibility of a sustainable future. So here's my photo. This is a photo of me when I was a little girl. I don't know what you see in the photo, but I would ask you, you know, which one is the local? Which one is the tourist? Or which one is the newcomer? If there are any Hawaii people in the, or anybody actually, where is this photo? Does anybody recognize where this photo might be?
Windward side?
Big Island?
Big Island, windward side. Okay. Well, actually, in this photo, I am the tourist, and the little girl in shorts is the native-born person. This is taken in Colorado, where my bare feet first touched mainland soil. My parents entered our family in a Boulder, Colorado parade, and since we had just achieved statehood, we had to carry a big banner that said, Aloha from your 50th state. We lived a very short time in Colorado, I think, until my parents realized how cold it was going to be, and we better get ourselves back to LA. Here's another photo. This is my uncle, Edison Uno, who was a redress activist and co-founder of ethnic studies at San Francisco State. He's with my paternal grandfather, who some would have known as a Japanese gardener. But he was an artist who immigrated to California in the 1920s. He came to the U.S. for religious freedom as a Christian. His mother was converted by Christian missionaries. And as Filipino-American journalist Jose Antonio Vargas says, he has a great immigration expression about immigration. We are here because you were there. My granddad changed his name to George after George Washington, and he began his American dream. But the laws of America meant that he was ineligible to own land. He was ineligible as an Asian to intermarry with a Caucasian. He was ineligible to become a citizen, and therefore ineligible to vote to change any of these laws, just like so many immigrants today. He married, he had 10 children. He gave all of them American names that were pretty unpronounceable in Japanese. He learned impeccable English. And shortly after Pearl Harbor, December 7th, 1941, the FBI knocked at the door of the house. They took him away. They were really thrilled to have evidence. He had boxes of his sketches, journals, letters to American friends that he kept copies of. He loved to write in English. And he was separated for years from his family. Most of my family were sent to Department of Interior concentration camps in Granada, Heart Mountain, Jerome, Arkansas. He was moved around the country secretly. They would not know where he was for months at a time. He was put in Department of Justice detention centers, you know, think Guantanamo, in North Dakota, Montana, New Mexico, and Texas. Meanwhile, three of my uncles volunteered for the US Army and served in segregated battalions in the 442 and the MIS. My grandfather was not released till fully 1 year after V-Day, the official end of the war. And I have been told that he was possibly the longest held Japanese American detainee. There was no trial or charges. Why do I share this story? One, I share this story because we are in a parallel era where racial profiling is targeting Black, Brown, Arab American, Muslims, and immigrants in general. And during World War II, that hysteria targeting the so-called enemy within allowed everyone else to look the other way while an entire people was sent to concentration camps. And this is not unlike what is happening now in immigration detention centers where women, men, and children are living in violation of human rights and facing mass deportation. We're living in a time of demographic hysteria, of who gets to be an American or who gets to be perceived as an American. The second reason I'm sharing this story with you is for us to understand this 2042 changing demographic moment. It is not a fluke. We did not just suddenly decide, let's have a few more kids,
or, you know, my cousin's coming to stay with us. No, you know, the United States was constructed legally as a white country through slavery, through disenfranchisement, through genocide and broken treaties, and discriminatory immigration laws. And the shift that we are experiencing now is directly a result of the activism of the 1960s, both the civil rights era legislation and particularly the 1965 Immigration and Naturalization Act, which has made the possibility of a pluralistic America possible. So you, we, our presence is connected to those marches, those sacrifices, those courageous activists of the 60s who held our country accountable as a project of democracy. I'm gonna show another slide. Has anyone seen this slide? It's a pretty shocking image. It's from 1854. I thought that since we're engaging the topic of yellowface, we need to look at how we intersect with blackface minstrelsy. You know, what are the roots of this masking tradition? This is by an anonymous Japanese artist in 1854, from when Commodore Perry opened Japan through to trade after 200 years of sovereignty. It was opened up by gunboat diplomacy. And this painting documents a minstrel show put on by the US naval officers for the Japanese shogunate. You remember Shogun, right? That movie, but starring Tom Cruise. Just saying. This also documents how African Americans were introduced into Japan, vis-a-vis both the military and blackface. And to remember that these happy black minstrel faces were performing at a time when slavery still existed in the US. The Civil War would not occur till the next decade. So I really want us to think about how culture controls the narrative and how deep and long-lasting these kinds of images are as we have our conversations today. As you can see, I'm deeply interested in intersectionality. Nina said, you know, that actually I started something called Intersections a long, long time ago, which was a gathering where I met many, many artists, some of whom are here today. I'm gonna show one other family photo. So this is a photo of my maternal grandmother. She's a Kufukuyama. She came to Los Angeles as a picture bride and married my grandfather on my maternal side on the day they met. She would never, ever, ever say that she was an artist, but she played the koto, she wrote poetry, she did calligraphy, and she was a clothing designer. She had a custom millinery and dressmaking shop in my grandfather's hardware store in Little Tokyo, downtown in LA. And there are plaques now that the Japanese American National Museum has put on the sidewalk that commemorate these businesses. So my grandfather's business is commemorated. But there are no plaques for the Japanese women who had businesses in their husbands' businesses, right? Mm-hmm. They are still invisible. And I think that this is part of the work I've been doing. A large part of my motivation is to find these hidden voices, which is why I did that first book, Unbroken Thread. Because as a college student, I never read plays that reflected me. And my work has really been about defying invisibility. It's catalyzed my writing, my directing, and my producing, and it's why I founded New World Theater in 79 and ran it for 23 years. When I was working there, Lucy Burns, the amazing Filipino-American scholar and dramaturg, and I started interviewing Asian American theater makers, including my mentor, Mako, at the East-West Players. And Lucy said something that was pretty profound. She talked about visiting Asian American theaters to do these interviews, and they were largely producing men's plays, but that she would find a trove of Asian American women writers when she asked if they kept rejected plays that were not produced. And that was the file cabinet where the women's writing voices would appear. That search led me to start looking for some of the earliest Asian American women playwrights. And I found a few that are still alive. Two in particular were from Hawaii,
I found Li Ling Ai, who wrote in the 1920s, who was still alive and living in New York in this like crowded apartment where you had to walk through this narrow canyon of books. And I found Wai Chi Chun at the end of her life in Hawaii. Wai Chi Chun told me about her mother having bound feet and how her mother was carried from the family's home, which was at the back of their store, to the cash register every day to cash out people. And that was her entire world, with her bound feet, this domestic space. Ling Ai Li, on the other hand, her world was enormous. She told me about going to China during the rape of Nanking and making a film. She told me about being in playwriting salons in New York City and said that her ideas were stolen to make the world of Susie Wong. And I really actually thought that she might be exaggerating or, you know, old and just kind of losing it. And then a couple of years ago, the filmmaker Robin Lung contacted me about a documentary she's making, Finding Kukan, and about how Li Ling Ai was erased as the co-director of one of the first Academy Award-winning documentaries, Kukan, on the rape of Nanking. So basically, that's what I've been doing for 40 years. I believe that's what we do as artists. We find that hidden human voice, we challenge boundaries, and we reveal the unexpected. And as a theater director and an Asian Pacific American woman, I've been inspired by mentors of all ages. But some are now ancestors, and so I'd like to mention them. James Baldwin, Yuri Kochiyama, Ellen Stewart, Mako, C. Bernard Jackson. And I'm going to show another slide.
Yes.
Grace. So I started a project. This is Grace Lee Boggs. When I came to the Ford Foundation in 2002, the first national convening I worked on was in Flint, Michigan. And I introduced Grace Lee Boggs to a national arts audience who did not know her at that time. I started a project called Arts in a Changing America out of CalArts, so I'm unfortunately going to be having to leave tomorrow morning because we're convening Art Change US Detroit, which is largely inspired by Grace and her legacy and featuring so many of the artists that she mentored. So, you know, because I ran a theater for so many decades, I never miss a chance to promote a good show in our season. And I was actually guilty of sometimes putting flyers into my children's backpacks. So I urge you to watch the live stream on HowlRound if you can this Thursday and Friday. I started today talking about the devastating times we're living in. And when things seem really unbearable for me, I often think WWJD. I think you've heard that term. For me, it means, what would Jimmy do? What would James Baldwin do? Or WWGD, what would Grace do? Baldwin told us that in order to be free, we need to listen. And Grace put it very simply. She said, we are the ones we are looking for. I would only add to that, in this changing demographic moment, we are no longer the counter-narrative. We are the narrative. So let's go on stage 2042.
Thank you.
difference between you and a Chinaman?
What do you mean?
Name some things. What are the differences?
The eyes.
Sure, but you got that covered nicely with the makeup. What else? Don't be shy. This is important. We're getting to the heart of the character.
Okay.
What are you doing?
Less body hair.
Good.
And I'd be.
Yes.
Bad at driving. Perhaps I got the smaller eyes. I should try to be shorter too.
That makes sense.
And penis.
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 Good. What about it?
Smaller.
Interesting.
And well, of course, I'd be, you know, naturally inscrutable.
Naturally. Good. Good.
So much less emotional, and you don't don't care as much about human life. Because it makes you more efficient. Right? That things like overpopulating the earth and building machines and hoarding wealth. Because you don't care so much about actual human emotion. I mean, I'm not making this up, you know what I'm saying, right?
There will be awkwardness. I expected a lot more whistles going on. Good morning. I am Mia Katigbak, a founding director of CAATA and the artistic producing director of NAATCO based in New York. The excerpt that you just saw is from Lloyd Suh's Charles Francis Chan Jr.'s Exotic Oriental Murder Mystery that NAATCO commissioned and which we produced last year.
Good night!
Charlie Chan is being asked some basic actorly questions by his Asian American director. I should give you some context. There was a purpose behind this casting, which is the use of a white actor in yellowface to expose white racism by using stereotypes because they are, in the words of the protagonist, they are so real. They are real white racist fictions that fuel a real white racist reality. Dave, the actor playing Charlie Chan, is being asked to speak about his character with whom, if we're gonna be Stanislavskian, he's supposed to identify with. In so doing, he exposes rather easily because he thinks it's just common sense, his racism. As my good friend, actually our friend, Jorge Cortinas, the playwright, puts it, quote, the yellow face in the play is actually the exposure of the white face, the white point of view. The white actor thinks he is telling us about his artistic process, but he is actually confessing his whiteness, end quote. It is ever thus. And because it is ever thus, we are here convening in an effort to achieve the seismic shift of neutralizing yellowface. In her keynote address on Saturday, Zeba Rahman spoke of artists as witnesses and first responders to social crises. Zeba also spoke of artists being able to take us to the essence of a problem in order to encourage response. In this instance, the use of yellowface is deployed by Lloyd in response to the continuing assaults on our cultures and our identities. Lloyd will speak more about this morning. Also here today joining us in the panel is Karan Shimakawa, who is the chair of the performance studies at NYU. What I'm hoping is that we can ask you guys to respond, and hopefully respond to each other as well. So may I ask you, Karan, to kick us off?
So I want to thank Mia and CAATA for inviting me to respond to this. I also want to thank Roberta because it's not only theater artists whose career she made possible. I feel like I'm here because of her as well, so thank you. So as Mia said, I'm an academic and not a theater artist or producer. So I'm also not a critic exactly, but I do sit usually on that side of the footlight, so I'm very disoriented up here. And so I think my job is to try to figure out what you people do does. So that means, number one, a quick apologies. That is, in my world, the academic world, we tend not to memorize our lines, and so and I'm a terrible improviser, so I have to read a little bit. And two, I think maybe what I'm going to say towards the end might not go over all that well, so you might want to keep those whistles ready. Okay, so I think my job is to sort of like do some kind of academic-y positioning, so I hope you'll bear with me with that. So on the one hand, it seems ridiculous that we're still asking this question, but on the other hand, if we are, I guess it's my job to sort of try to offer some answers to it. The question being, what is the injury of yellowface? Or rather, how does it work? How does it work? I think everybody in the room knows, after all, what yellowface is, kind of, and many of us know where it comes from, and what's wrong in the sense of what's inaccurate about it. We also all know the nature of the injury. We can speak to the shame or the rage that we feel when we're confronted by it, but how exactly does it injure? So the racist performance of yellowface is a way of being called, or in my job, my whatever, we call it being hailed by a hateful identity or term. In a way, it's a form of naming, right, or describing for whatever the performers might claim about it being either a quaint historical relic, think the Mikado, or playful imaginative fiction, think Miss Saigon, I don't know. It obviously references and thereby implicitly describes Asian bodies in the real contemporary world. Moreover, and here's the kicker, is that in answering that hail, that is for Asian Americans to speak back to that hail, and many times the only way we can is to become visible as that racist persona. I think for the actors in the room, you can think about like what kind of roles are you able to audition for, which things you get asked to play. That's the sort of, you know, you're answering this certain kind of hail, right? So Judith Butler, who's a feminist philosopher of language, asks, okay, so we understand that that's what happens. There are only certain kinds of ways that you can become visible in the mainstream, and oftentimes those ways are racist. But she says, so what else happens? What could happen in that hailing? The way she puts it, she says, is there a way to find vulnerabilities in that oppressive force that's expressed in the hail? That is, can you answer that call, but maybe answer it in a way that's a little bit fucked up, right? So that you are just legible enough that you get your foot in the door, but maybe kind of mess with the perception a little bit. So I think, I'm sure you guys are all super familiar with that strategy. And if you'll permit me, and thank you for doing that. I am gonna get to the video, and I know we're short for time, but I wanna take a slight detour, because I can't resist, through a legal case that I suspect many of you may know something about. I'm also interested in the law. So you might know about it either because you're an Oregonian, or you read the newspaper, or you are a fan of high energy dance rock that is so popular with young people today, I hear. I'm talking, of course, about the slants and the U.S. Supreme Court case. The U.S. Supreme Court just announced that they're going to hear this case this fall, so it's super exciting. I'm going to just talk about it super briefly for those of you who don't know, and then I promise I will move on. So the slants are a Portland-based band starting in 2006 with four Asian American musicians. Simon Tam, who's the bassist, described their choice of the name and their sort of iconography this way. He said, we want to take on these stereotypes that people have about us, like the slanted eyes, and own them. So in 2010, Tam filed an application to register the slants as a trademark, and the examining attorney found the mark disparaging to people of Asian descent, and therefore refused to register it. One of the criteria for the Trademark Act, right? So he and his lawyers appealed this a couple times, they lost a couple times, and then on the last appeal, they actually got a positive ruling where the Court of Appeals found the part of the Trademark Act that that disqualified him as unconstitutional. And so now that's why it's going up to the Supreme Court. Okay, so there's a lot of like nerdy legal stuff to be said about this, but I will spare you. But the reason I think of this is because, presumably the slants can still call themselves the slants even without the trademark, but there's a value to that name, right? And there's a value to prohibiting other people from using that name, that is from shutting other people down from using the word. And I'm sort of interested in that play between being able to sort of appropriate the term, but also censoring somebody else from using it in a way you don't like. So here we come back to Butler. Judith Butler makes this point, you know, about injurious speech when she's talking about hate speech, and she says, okay, so hate speech is bad, it injures people, but she's very suspicious about possibly prohibiting it, that is, making it against the law, for precisely the reason that once you lock down an injurious value, sort of association with the word, it stays injurious, right? And you can't re-signify it, it only becomes that hateful term. So she's actually against hate speech legislation precisely so that people can start messing with that word and kind of appropriating it different ways, right? So rather than to say, you know, this word is injurious, this image, this mode of performance is injurious, and that's why we need to shut it down, she argues that we actually just need more speech, more proliferation of the possibilities. So in thinking about this in terms of the Slants case, which I've been doing, if the Slants case shows us anything, it's that the words depend on context, right? Who's speaking matters, how it's being used matters, the political context matters. So if we want Simontam and the Slants to be able to use that, we have to think about, all right, we have to be willing to admit a variety of contexts for this kind of hateful representation, right? And the possibility that that could do maybe some good. Let me skip ahead. So going to, so Butler actually makes a point, let me skip ahead, I don't want to take up too much time. The reason I've been thinking about this is that last week I taught another essay in my class, another essay by Butler, one that doesn't get a lot of play, but I think it should, and especially in conjunction with the kind of stuff we're talking about today. That essay was written in the aftermath of the trial of four police officers and the beating of a black man, and despite what looked to many like clear and stark video evidence of police brutality, which put the victim in a coma and resulted in permanent disfigurement. The jury watched that same video and saw the black man with hands raised, palm out in self-defense. They saw him as a violent aggressor, and they acquitted the four policemen. So does this ring a bell or sound familiar to anyone? Sadly, my students had never heard of Rodney King, which kind of broke my heart a little bit. So Butler argued that the jury in the Rodney King case descriptively saw a black man as a threat, but that what they were actually doing was interpretively reading. They didn't just see something that was objectively there, right? They were reading based on what Frantz Fanon calls an epidermal schema. So her point about this is that it's a political act so she sees something else in the video, but she acknowledges that her own seeing, that is of a victim defending himself, her seeing is an aggressive interpretive reading too, but she says it's a political act to sort of counter overread the other way. So my point here is just that her aggressive counter reading, or our aggressive counter reading of all the videos that we're seeing like every day now, is only possible if we keep that interpretive latitude in play. Locking things down by saying you can't show this or you can't do that, or even I can say that word, but you are legally barred from saying it, may ultimately serve only to give power to that word or that image and to cement the injurious power to the word. So for that reason, I'm not sure, to go back to the Slants, I'm not sure the trademark registration is really the way to go, although I want him to win because, you know, we want him to win. More cynically, because I worry that if the term stays profitable, even in an ironic relation to its hateful connotation, that a hateful connotation still carries with it. And if you want proof of this, just go read all of the legal briefs that are online with this case, because they just dredge up every other case of like hateful trademarks that people have either tried to or successfully done, right? And so I didn't even know these trademarks existed until I read this case, and they're like, oh my God, somebody tried to trademark that thing. So it just keeps those things in circulation in a hateful way. So in the theater, what does this mean? Should we be trying to shut down bad yellow face productions? Well, on an non-legal way, sure. I don't want to buy tickets to those things, right? But shutting them down, before they're able to be produced, I do have questions about, and they're genuine questions. because I worry that it gives them another kind of cultural power. We can't erase or censor the past, so I wonder, is there a way, like Lloyd's play, to somehow recirculate those images, to better tap that sort of hateful energy in ways that start to undermine the power of that image to name us in the present? I think that Lloyd's play as a whole is an excellent example of this. And I love this monologue because it's so subtly and well done and performed. So Yellowface is a hateful, injurious naming of Asianness. It's read or performed as in some ways as an aggressive counter-hailing in the way that Butler counter-reads the Rodney King video. What I really like about it is it's more than a simple negation. That is, it's not just that, you know that yellow face mask is not true. I mean, certainly that's part of it, but the mask as a racist mask is sort of performed, but also we get to see the ways in which, and here I'm actually thinking about the play more generally, the ways in which Asians can and do deploy that mask as well, because that's not the only person that does yellow face in the play. Both for better and for worse, right? There are all kinds of ways in which this can go awry in super interesting ways. And so I won't give you that how it comes out, but all of this is to say that, sorry, no spoilers, but the mask is interesting to look at because sometimes a mask can come back and bite you on the ass. And these are only available if we are able to look at it and let that thing actually show up on stage. So I guess this is just a call for more yellow face in a weird way. No, that's not what I mean. But something like the possibility of proliferation of those sorts of images, I think, can only give them less power, weirdly. So.
This might sound like an obvious thing to say, but I mean, honestly, I really hate talking about yellowface. I really, really hate it. It there might be kind of a weird thing to say. This is like the third panel that I've done this year where the title has the word yellowface in it, and I've been asked to do at least 10 more. I just can't, and I acknowledge that, totally. And I have spent, you know, because I have spent a certain amount of time, personally and professionally, in the energy around yellowface, and it's, you know, some of it intentional, most of it not intentional. The intentional part is definitely a part where it's about me trying to encounter and grapple with and find some sort of personal catharsis around those issues. Because a lot of those issues, you know, are things that have visited me in ways that were not necessarily welcome. And it's a very dehumanizing, demeaning, discouraging energy to live in. You know, what I do in my life is I'm a playwright, and I'm an arts administrator who works at an organization that is dedicated to trying to support, nurture, and advance the work of playwrights who are exploring and illuminating the most important issues of our time. I recognize that in the current moment that we're living in, that yellow face conversations are important. You know, it's why I have agreed to have conversations around this topic in a few instances, and I am very appreciative of this particular space. I'm very appreciative of CAATA and this conference, and OSF for hosting it. I was fortunate enough to be on the founding steering committee that created the National Asian American Theater Conference and Festival, and I know that the mission there is to advance and celebrate and build the community around the work of Asian American theaters and artists. It's not necessarily to spend our time or our energy dealing in reacting to other people's shit. And I feel like that's what I'm spending more and more of my time on. You know, costs us something. It really does cost us something. It's cost me something personally, and I'm not, you know, well, I shouldn't say that, whatever. It costs us something to spend our energy there. And it's also, it's just a real drag. And the reason it's a drag is because there's also this recognition when we're encountered with these situations that there's hostility, right? That there's hostility in the world. There's hostility to us, to our own ownership of our identity. There's hostility to us not fitting into a box. There's hostility to like everything that we're, like all the changing demographic stuff and the dismantling of those power structures, who actually wields that power. You know, for the people who have the power, they like the way things are going because it's going pretty well for them, right? And so any disruption to that power structure, and the ability for Asian Americans and for us to define our own identity in this political climate is a disruption. And so, I mean, we know where this hostility is coming from, right? These changing demographics are a big part of it. The louder and more empowered we become, the more and more we're gonna get a backlash. It's the same place that Donald Trump comes from, right? It's the same place that energy comes from. And that's what we're up against. So when I think about like the topic at hand, which is how do we neutralize yellow face, I think that neutralizing yellow face, obviously that needs multiple strategies. And I'm looking at the schedule of this conference, and I'm like, it's very exciting to see the many ways in which there are multiple strategies being addressed. But I think that even more than these questions about this energy about reacting to other people's shit, I think that the thing that I believe is the hill that I want to die on, that I think is the most effective strategy for neutralizing the yellow face, is the advancement of the extraordinary community of Asian American playwrights that are generating and developing work right now. We're in a incredible time. We're Asian American playwrights. I'm not gonna name, because I know like it's going to take a long time, and also I'm going to leave people out, but you know who they are. Right? You know who they are, and if you don't, then ask each other. Everybody know, you know who they are, and if you do, for those of you who don't know who they are, ask around. You should know who they are. For those of you who do know who they are, talk about them all the time. Talk about them with anybody who will listen, because even though there is extraordinary work being done by Asian American playwrights right now that are excavating our history, examining our present, and imagining our future in a way that nobody else is and nobody else has. The fact of the matter is there are still, like the numbers of representation are still appalling. The opportunities that these writers have to actually be produced and to be widely disseminated, to be understood, to be taught in schools, to be spoken of, is not nearly where it should be. And so I think it's our job to spend our energy trying to make those representations as visible and as loud and as present as possible and enduring as possible. And I think that, like I would say to Asian American playwrights, yes, you're doing incredible work, but I also think, you know what, we can still do better. Like we can always, and I challenge myself every day, and I challenge all of you every day to always, always, always do better. And I don't know how you guys grew up, with a lot of Asian Americans here, but the way I grew up is my parents told me that, I had to be twice as good as the other kids in order to get half as much credit. And that's a drag too, to have to do that, but I think we can do it. I think we can, I think we're up for it. So, and I think that we should be spending the correct, there's a proportional amount of time we should be spending on celebrating and advancing and promoting that work versus reacting to stuff, talking about the Mikado. And I don't know what the proportion is, but it should be an enormous proportion. And so I guess that's what
I'm so sorry. This is such a rich conversation, I think, and we're very, very constrained by time. But we have kind of designed additional opportunities to continue this kind of conversation, because what Lloyd has said in terms of strategies, I think the more strategies we have, the better we are, and to maybe change the balance of that so that the positive energies are that proportion goes up. But I also see value in what Karan is saying, and it's a very complicated conversation, I believe. There are at least, that I know of, two other sessions that will follow this that will continue to kind of explicate and unpack this, and hopefully we step up to Lloyd's challenge in terms of putting the positive energy and creative and collaborative and cooperative efforts towards that thing. In a half an hour, there's another panel that will talk more historically, and I know that tomorrow there's also another one that's, I think Randy mentioned it, in case of yellow face, break glass. I'd like to thank these wonderful folks for being here, and I'm so sorry, I would love to, may we have time for Roberta to respond?
I was just thinking about how when I was in high school, my brother dragged me to a protest for Lovely Ladies and Kind Gentlemen, which the Center Theater Group was producing in Los Angeles. And then when I was on the East Coast, then it was Miss Saigon, of course. And but when I was in college, I wrote my first play, and the department chose to produce it. And we worked on the production team, and they're like, we want to give you so-and-so as a lighting designer, and so-and-so for costume, and so-and-so, and but we're going to have to bring in a guest artist to do the mask work. And I said, well, why? I don't have any masks in the script. And they said, well, you wrote, the play has, like, all Asian leads, or Oriental leads. It has, you know, 10 people in it, and they're all Asian. And I was, like, really militant. I was just like, well, I'm gonna cast that show, and we're gonna, you know, and I'm gonna do that show, and I don't need masks, and I don't need people, I'm, you know, totally rejecting yellow face. And then, of course, I held auditions, and there were no Asian American actors showing up. And so then I started accosting people, like, you look like you could act. Do an actor training workshop with me, or? And so that's when I just said, okay, what I'm gonna have to do is approach this like, you know, I had been a community organizer for the United Farm Workers. I'm gonna approach this like community organizing and start organizing the workshops and recruiting people. And, you know, I was working in a boutique, so I met lots of Asian American women that were really pretty cool looking. And so I think for me anyway, I've always questioned, you know, it's just like blood donorship. Why is it that there's kind of this universal donor, universal recipient, and why should Caucasian actors get to play everything? I think we should get to play everything as well. And so my when I started it and why I started it was because I did not want to spend my energy just protesting. I feel like I could just actually have a nervous breakdown every day if I just react to all the shit out there. And I also feel like for us to train ourselves to put our own narratives out there. And the last thing I will say is just as an artistic director, I never believed in matching people. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's an Asian play, so I need, oh, you look like you could direct that. So when we produced Nefertiti Burton's play, Letters to a Student Revolutionary by Elizabeth Wong, I asked Nefertiti Burton to direct it because she'd had years of going to China, being in China, even though I looked more like that play. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? So I've always cast, I mean, Lloyd working with Jorge Cortines, you know, it doesn't necessarily mean you work producing him. It doesn't mean that you have to match the person. Yes. And I think that's really important because we tend to get reduced and categorized and essentialized.
Well, I think at least there's been a little bit of progress. If you have that casting call right now, you'd have a room full of Asian Americans coming to.
Absolutely. This is in college, in the five colleges in Amherst, Massachusetts.
Oh, yes.
Which sometimes that isolation, like people who are working not on the coast, it's actually in some ways more empowering for you because uh-huh. You're the ones who are making everything that is important happen where you are.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I wish you
all right. it's Mia. And we have the, we want to thank our sponsors, that's very important, money, and our partners. Oh my God, how can we? We need all the beautiful logos, yes. Great. also, Multnomah Library System, we want to, Library System, we want to thank them. Conference sessions will be at the Hay Patton across from Bricks. Walk to the left of the Thomas Theater, and if you don't know where that is, that's hard. And in Australia. Also, join us tonight at our kickoff event at Grizzly Peak Winery, sponsored by Grizzly Peak Winery and the Southern Oregon Chinese Cultural Association. That's a natural partnership there. And all the information is in your program guide. There'll be a bus to transport you to and from Grizzly Peak Winery, and they'll have you back here in time for Hot Asian Everything, a seismic extravaganza. Right here in this space at 8 p.m. tonight. Thank you all, welcome, and enjoy the conference. And-